AbCellera stock, or ABCL stock, is down 23% since our last piece, which is about 10 months ago. Now, you always need to put performance numbers in perspective. So the NASDAQ was up 30% over the same time frame. Now, there's nothing wrong with a quality company having their share price fall, because that's great if you're a buyer of the stock. However, that limits a company's ability to raise capital. So we want to explore how their engine is progressing. So this AI-powered drug development engine. Now, what we found wasn't too promising, and we're going to talk about that. Now, we've covered AbCellera in a number of previous pieces. We look at it about once every year, and this update is coming a little bit sooner because our paying subscribers, the people who pay our bills, want an update. Now, how things started for AbCellera: they were founded in 2012. They had a very successful IPO, so it was something like 20 times oversubscribed, and they raised $555 million. Around that time, you could see the chart here on the right, and they were generating a ton of revenue and profits. This was because of the Rona, and when they had that IPO, shares traded the first day around $70 versus their IPO price of $20, giving them a market cap of about $12.5 billion. From 2020 to 2022, they earned nearly $1 billion in combined royalties from commercial sales of two Rona-related drugs. And the idea there is that, well, they proved the usefulness of their platform, indeed. But today, it's a different story. So they're now a $1.35 billion company with $780 million in cash. So essentially, you're getting a drug discovery company for about $570 million with the same platform that everybody was excited about before. So what's the cause of this share price decline? Well, this year's investor deck provides a lot more color than we've seen in the past. Now, if you're going to value AbCellera, what you'd want to do is run a Monte Carlo analysis and use these various factors. So the number of downstream stakes they have in drug discovery programs, meaning that if there's a success or something that progresses down the stages of the drug development pipeline, then they'll receive some milestone payments for that. The probability of success for a drug discovery program, something that gets commercialized, the timeline it takes to reach these milestones, potential for upfront payments, so you'd see that fairly quickly. The resulting commercial sales, it's very important if you're talking about royalties. And they talk about how most of the value is being defined by their royalty rates. We'll look at that. Indeed, that's the case. And you need to take all this and try to value a lot of unpredictable future events. Now, the company today is valued a lot lower. And what I think is important here is being very aware of things that fail or don't progress, because then they don't prove the validity of this platform, which says we deliver lead candidates in less time and with a higher probability of success. So if things aren't proceeding through the pipeline, that's a big problem, right? That's what they say they do. So let's start by looking at the two major components of their business model. So what they call partner-initiated program starts. You can see here they have 87 with downstream participation. That means that it isn't just a company using their platform, paying, and then going away. They have the potential for downstream revenues from drug discovery all the way through the development of these drugs. Now, when we talk about volume versus focus, we're very interested in this idea of an engine that churns out loads of winners for a small royalty without this firm having to do anything except maintain their platform. What we might think of as the antibody engines or the antibody discovery engine. So let's forget about their focused pipeline for a second, the drugs that they're trying to bring to market, and just look at this engine. So if they have 203 programs under contract with 46 partners, 55% of these, or 112, have been initiated. In other words, they're being worked on. 43% of these, 87, have downstream upside. So we're very interested in knowing more about the progress here. Why? Because this represents that engine potential that I talked about. Now, before I get into that, I wanted to introduce myself. So my name's Joe Pivarunas. I'm the founder of Nanalyze. And this picture actually was taken in the Czech Republic, where I am now. And I'm flying in an Aero L29 Delphin there. Now, I love a number of things a lot. That would be adventures, especially technology, and of course, helping people become better investors. It's very satisfying. So if you want to join me and my staff on this journey, then Wyatt, who's our head of operations, is going to put a link in the comments section of this video to our newsletter. And if you sign up to that, we'll show you how wealth gets created and preserved over time. Now, the process may be slow and boring, but I can promise you the people teaching you are anything but. So let's look at the progress that AbCellera has made with the 87 programs that have started. So they still have 23 in progress. Fine. What about the 64 that were completed? Well, this is not good. So 26 of those are not expected to progress. That's a 41% failure rate on completed projects. Why is that? Well, we probably don't, we'll never know, because a lot of that stuff is confidential. But when we look at what they describe as understood to be progressing, we see some promising stuff, right? 3 clinical development, 5 preclinical development, 30 late stage discovery. And when they talk about understood to be progressing, we might define that as maybe there's some sort of quarterly or annual check-in with their previous or current partners. Now, let's pretend they're milestones. You can see these in the table below, $8.55 billion worth of potential milestones. Let's pretend those are spread evenly across 200 programs. So for preclinical, you're looking at what, about $400,000 on the average preclinical milestone. Then it goes up from there to $5.35 million for clinical, $9.7 for regulatory, and then $27.3 for commercial, and then you have royalties. So you can see that it's very important that they should see some progress through the drug discovery pipeline in the later stages in order for them to realize the potential of their business, or what they're describing here with this table of $8.55 billion they could potentially capture. And when you look at the drug development timeline, so this was taken from BioStock, and these numbers are debatable, but just to give you a general idea, we might say that from preclinical through clinical, it probably takes a drug, let's say, 7 years. And what percentage of these drugs might not make it through? It could be canceled for any number of reasons. So as we've said multiple times in previous videos, we really want to see some more later stage progress for that helps prove the viability of this platform that supposedly reduces time and increases likelihood of success. Now, I love this chart that they provided in their investor deck. And as I said, their new investor deck is pretty slick. It gives you what you need to know. You see here, of course, their revenues fell off a cliff there because they're no longer making money on the Rona. That's the green you see there. But their research fees have declined. That seems to go along with this idea of ye old macroeconomic headwinds that we're seeing in general biotech and pharma spending. So that can be explained away. But then look at milestones and licensing. So not very much money there, right? Again, drugs that are in the early stage aren't expected to bring in a lot of money. So the promise of this company is really what comes down the road. And when we look at this other component, what they describe as molecules in the clinic. So they say 13, but honestly, it seems like only 6. And here's why. So first of all, let's scratch out anything that says expect no further progress. That's pretty self-explanatory, right? You could see the two from Lilly, that's the Rona, and then one from Denali here, and then one undisclosed. So you have of the 13, 4 expect no further progress. Well, why even list them? Well, they want to show that they had molecules actually reaching the clinic, but they don't mean anything going forward. So let's call that 9. Then we have animal health here. Now, we've crossed that out because you have 3 molecules for animal health. So that's about a $10 billion sales per year in the U.S., let's say $30 billion globally. That's not really the sort of a big rewards we're after. So we've scratched those out. And then that leaves us 6 candidates. And everything remaining is in phase 1 development. And 4 of them belong to one company, NovaRock. So we're curious about that, and we noted here the Triani license. Now, our criticisms before were that this mouse model they acquired, and you can watch our previous pieces or read our research pieces on our website that talk about this stuff, right? Been following this company for a while. What they acquired with the Triani acquisition, That shouldn't have been part of the primary value add for their platform that's been worked on since 2012. So if they didn't acquire Triani, in other words, without that, we'd be at 5 molecules, excluding the expect no further stuff. If you remove the 3 animal molecules, and you're left with 2. So that's not that impressive, to be honest. And when we dig into NovaRock, I pulled this up from their website, and we're not industry experts by any means, but this is a small private company that doesn't look overly compelling. They didn't have any management bios, but a search on LinkedIn shows they have staff, which is great. It doesn't look like the best foot forward for AbCellera. So you look at their co-development partner, Leap Therapeutics. That's a $60 million company that doesn't appear to have a pot to piss in. I think they have just $70 million in cash. So what are they going to use to progress candidates? They acquired Flame Biosciences, which was a company that NovaRock was working with before. So when you look at the long list of companies that AbCellera has been working with over the years, since 8 years ago, you see names like Pfizer, Novartis, Eli Lilly, of course, that was the Rona stuff, right? Regeneron, AbbVie. And they talk about, you know, we are increasingly focused on strategic partnerships. So isn't that what you have here? You know, expanding relationships with large pharma and large biotech. What have you been doing over the past 8 years? Isn't that what you were doing? You know, maybe it goes back to this company is no longer focused on that engine model that we found so attractive, and now they're focused on really bringing drugs to market themselves, or getting into bed much more closely with some of these firms. Now, the problem with that is that it's going to increase their expenditures. And when you look at drugs that AbCellera wants to bring to market themselves, so they talk about they're going to have first 2 IND submissions. You can see what that is here. Essentially, it's something you need to conduct with the regulatory authorities before you can start phase 1, 2, and 3 testing. They plan for these 2 molecules to submit in 2025. And they said, we intend to take additional first-in-class development candidates into IND-enabling studies in this year and next. Well, what does that mean then? So 9 years until something gets commercialized? Okay, they say, oh, we can bring them faster. Well, 6 years? That's still a long time to wait. In the meantime, they're spending a whole bunch of money. So I don't know why they need a new headquarters, but apparently they're moving into one. And they're also building these capabilities in this new building you see here, which is supposedly going to advance pipeline and partnerships. And they were able to secure $220 million from the Canadian government for lab and office construction. And of course, that means they had to pony up another $300 million. And they say, well, that's going to help create more capabilities and accelerate the ability for them to partner with more companies. Well, they're certainly spending a lot of money, and we need to see some results eventually from that. And you see they say here, well, funding will allow us to advance more pre-partnered programs. They keep talking about that. And we believe success in these programs will drive value in multiple dimensions of our business. And they look at CapEx here and say that, well, internal programs and pipeline, right, the stuff they're driving forward themselves, is going to consume 40% of their capital allocation. Don't expect that to drop over time. And these partnered programs, they're looking at 20% there. And then continuing to build their engine, which they seem to be backing off of, frankly, is based on what we just talked about. That's going to consume 40% of their CapEx. They talk about a manufacturing facility. Well, you have to have something to manufacture. So where they're sitting right now on cash, I think the last time we analyzed this, we incorrectly calculated runway based on the operating cash flows there of minus $44 million. But there appears to be a lot of runway based on just operating costs. But what about investing? So they're going to be developing these drugs in-house. That's going to consume cash. And when you have a very depressed share price, it's not good to go out to the market and try to raise more money. So just some parting thoughts here. AbCellera is one of 2 AI drug discovery stocks we'd think about holding, provided they can prove their platform more. We need to see more late-stage success stories. We're not liking the number of not expected to progress coming out of the engine, and the expect no further progress for molecules in the clinic isn't good either, the Rona being the exception, of course. And that whole NovaRock thing seems off. I mean, does anyone out there have more color on this private company that accounts for 44% of AbCellera's molecules in the clinic? If you do, please drop a comment in the comment section. It'd be interesting to hear. Now, if they need to raise capital, Debt could certainly be an option. They only have around $71 million in long-term debt currently. But this focus of the company away from their engine and more to drugs they're developing themselves or partnering with other companies to develop is really testing how much we like this company, frankly. Now, another AI drug discovery stock we like, we recently covered. I'll leave you with this video to watch. Please make sure you're subscribed to our channel. Sign up to our newsletter that's in the comments section. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this today.